Tom Furuheim, living in Nordkisa, just outside the Gardermoen Airport, Oslo. I work as an airline pilot and do guitar work and building guitars on a hobby basis. I've always been interested in music. I played drums almost my whole life, and my son turned out to be a very good guitarist, and that's how I got into building guitars. He wanted a new acoustic guitar because he had a Martin D35 he wasn't happy with. And as he said, you can make one much better than this one. And that's how it started. You know, took me a year researching, you know, woods, tools, all the equipment I needed, and also to get to read me up on a bit of knowledge on guitar building, constructions and everything. So I ended up around 30 guitars total. And then it started to get a bit serious. It wasn't a hobby anymore. It took all my spare time, so I just quit. Didn't have any fun anymore. So I sold all my equipment for making acoustic guitars then. A couple of years afterwards, a friend of mine wanted a new electric guitar. So I built him a Telecaster, and I was very happy with that one. And then again, the telephones started to ring, you know, I need another guitar and so on. And but now I try to keep it on a hobby basis. So I mostly family, friends and so on that gets guitars, because with the airline job, it's I don't have any much spare time. All guitars from Mr. Leo Fender is very basic, extremely simple, built as a kit. His idea was, if you had a neck problem, you can change the neck, you could change every component. And I like that philosophy. I love Stratocasters and have great respect for Mr. Leo Fender and all his constructions. So I started out building Telecasters and Stratocasters because of that, the simplicity and the durability of them. But even though you have to have good parts, good wood and everything. So the process starts with selecting the wood. Right now I use Norwegian black alder for my body constructions, and maple, hard rock maple for the necks, and also rosewood for fingerboards. I have also a selection with Brazilian rosewood, but very limited. It's extremely expensive to get hold of, and you have the CITES bureaucracy and everything to keep in mind when you deal with that kind of woods. So now mostly I use high-grade Indian rosewood for my guitars. And after that, it's try to follow the recipe that Mr. Leo made back in the day. Try to build them as authentic as the old 50s and 60s as you can. I have a few upgrades with double-action truss rods and so on that makes the guitar more usable, user-friendly in our climate, with high humidity, low humidity and all that kind of stuff. So, otherwise I keep them as close to the original recipe as possible. I had done a couple of restorations of old 60s Strats, and I was fortunate enough to have them on my table, make all the measurements and made all my plans from the original 63s, 62s and so on.
Did you also read about...
Oh yes. Yeah. kind of a nerdy thing, but you read everything about these old guitars. There's a lot of very good books and so on. So I think that's part of the hobby. You know, I love instruments, not only Fenders, but all kinds of instruments. They have all their histories and everything. So I think that's a big part of it. Not just make a guitar and be done with it. It's got to have soul. That's, I think that is important.
en radio, så... Majones.
On the neck?
Yeah.
The clay tools? Yeah, originally there is two versions there. Someone insists that Fender used fiber boards and stamped out the inlays. And others say it's some sort of clay they made to fill the holes in the neck. I'm not sure which one is right. There's very little written about that. But I think it's clay because of the consistency I've seen on originals. I also removed a couple of them and it doesn't look like a fiberboard. You know, rosewood has a lot of oil in it and that the clay will suck and make it darker over years. Some of these old guitars, they have very, very dark inlays, almost unanimous with the rest of the neck. And I tried to replicate that with the coloring, the clay, to the right amount of browning before I bake the clay and insert them into the neck. So it looks more uniform old, if you know what I mean. Not the bright white dots on an old guitar. So that's kind of cool. Try to make them as authentic as I can. I weigh the wood before I start so I can get in one weight regime that I like, that I found out is the most resonant for my guitars. So if I find the right weight and everything, it can be a bit of search to make a really good guitar. Then I set the thickness with, I have some machines that plane them down to the right thickness. And then I cut out the contours and route out all the cavities and everything. And it's a lot of sanding, so mask on and just go at it, you know. Thank you. And also choosing the electronics and what the customer wants for the profile of the neck and everything. If I'm really fortunate, the customer can come here and feel the neck before I do the finish on it. So we can specify the neck profile for his hand.
Do you think is it difficult to build a really good strat?
Not really. As I said initially, it's the most basic instrument ever made, and that's what makes it so unique, I think. And that's also why it's so challenging to build. You have to be very precise on, especially on the setup. You can have a very good Fender guitar, Fender Custom Shop, everything that is almost unplayable. I had one here. We used hours and hours and hours on the setup on a really expensive Fender Custom Shop guitar. And we finally got it playing. There was a double bow in the neck, so I had to defret it and level the whole neck again. That's kind of a bummer if you buy a guitar to $10,000, you know, and have to do all that work with it. But that's the way it is sometimes. Mostly they are all good, but the setup is the most important on the strut. The height of the pickups, the intonation. Intonation has to be spot on a Stratocaster, otherwise it won't sound good. After that, it's finished. I use mostly on these old copies, I use nitrocellulose lacquer. And also 95% of them want a relic look, you know, the aged, so they look 60 years old. And that's an art in itself, I think, to make it look realistic and not just go at it with sandpapers and scuffing and optics. It has to look used.
And actually, that's part of the process that it's a bit, you're a bit secretive about, because...
Yeah, I use a lot of different tools and techniques and everything to make it so I think it looks realistic. And that has been a lot of trial and error and intuitive stuff. So I don't want to show everything I do, but mostly if people ask me what I do for this and that, I'll tell them. That's not a secret. But things I've done, used many years on, you know, to figure out the process, I'll keep that to myself. After that, I'll let the paint rest for a while, because nitrocellulose, it's hardened by gassing off. It's not like 2K paints and stuff that hardens with a chemical reaction. So here you have the nitrocellulose gases off, so it has to lay for 3 to 4 weeks before you can polish it and so on. So and that's very important, otherwise it won't look right. So after that, it's fine sanding and polishing, and then I do the relicking. So basically the guitar looks brand new, then I start tearing it down again. So crazy, but and I know a lot of people hate that, but I love it. I think it's cool, and it's very rewarding to see a guitar and feel a guitar that feels like it's 60 years old. So
did you say that like 95% of customers?
Yes. If they want a strap from me, it's gonna be a relic one. That's 95%. So that's cool. Right. Then it's assembly, and then again, I let it hang. I assemble it, let it hang for a few days, so it will, the tension will stabilize a bit. Then I do the setup and set the nut tights, the intonation and everything. And hopefully it sounds good.
Your Strat is called the Golden Era Strat, right? What is that based on?
I base it on, initially in 1962, I was born in 62. But I've had a couple of old ones in my shop, and the 62s are exceptional from what I can tell. So I based them on primarily on the 62, all the way from 1960 up to 64, 65. And also some 57s, 56s, which has the maple neck and so on. Now we get into the nerdy stuff, you know, how many holes there are in the pickguards and everything's open. But I like to make them as authentic as possible to the years.
Is there anything that you can pinpoint to why, like, the 62 is better? Is it even possible?
Many people say it's because of the lacquer was very thin in 1962, that you get a more resonant guitar. I don't know, but the shape of the neck on the 62s is different from the others, especially from the earliers. And after 62, they got a bit thinner, and I don't like that, the thin necks. If Strats, you have to work to play it, and then you need something to hold on to. That's my my take on it, but I make the neck you want. If you want a skinny neck, you get a skinny neck, but everything else is authentic, as good as you can get. I found out what sounds best on my guitars with the wood selection I got now, a Norwegian alder and that stuff. I found a Dutch company called Rebel Relic. They make extremely good Strat pickups. They have three different ones in the series now. They have a 54, a 63 and a Steve Ray Vaughan replicas. They all sound amazing, but the 54 is just extremely resonant in my guitars. There's very different response from the pickup in guitars. People don't think that, but it is actually is very different. You can have one pickup sounds great in that guitar and not so great in another one. But all of the Rebel Relics that I have used, absolutely stunning.
Mm-hmm.